absolutely fortunate to have Dr. Yohuru Williams with us this evening. You can see his name and the title of his talk. But he's a native of Bridgeport, Connecticut. And as the way that life cycles, that's where my father was during World War II before he enlisted in the Marine Corps. And so here's a native of Bridgeport. He went on to the University of Scranton and then took his PhD at Howard University. And of course, you know, Howard is kind of like the African-American Adams State on the East Coast. It's an HBC, but the jewel in the crown of the HBC constellation. Dr. Williams is an expert on many things, including stuff that didn't exist as a scholarly topic when I was young, hip-hop culture and the, you know, the politics of community and protest. His longer expertise is with the Black Panther Party, and his first book was on the Black Panther Party in New Haven, Connecticut, which suggests for some of us that there was a movement outside of the Mississippi Delta. So I've talked on long enough, but I want to thank you again for being here, and I want you to give a big Adams State welcome to our keynote speaker, Dr. Yohuru Williams.
Thank you. How's everybody doing tonight? That's good. I don't think I need this mic either, but I'm going to use it. Testing, 1, 2. Testing, great. So you always have kind of a backup plan when you do something like this. I thought I was going to have an audience of students. So I had one talk prepared for them and one talk prepared for slightly, shall we say, more seasoned audience. So you'll get the slightly more seasoned audience talk. What I want to talk about with you tonight for roughly about 40 minutes or so is the fierce urgency of now, lessons from the civil rights movement. And I want to do so in a way that really, in some sense, comes to grips with the contemporary moment that we find ourselves in. So everyone knows that tomorrow we will inaugurate a new president of the United States. But the last year, 8 years of American history have been interesting because, despite the fact that we had the election of the nation's first African-American history, the long shadow of slavery and inequality continues to haunt us in ways that are palpable, socially, economically, politically, culturally, in this country. I love this political cartoon for any number of reasons, because it's this image of Uncle Sam, and behind him, the shackled image of a slave. And I think in some sense that approximates part of the problem, but it's deeper than that. Ed talked about the book that I just published, Rethinking Black Liberation Struggles. And one of the reasons that I agreed to write that book with Rutledge is I felt like, in a lot of ways, the civil rights movement is no longer accessible to people. We saw this past weekend when Congressman John Lewis questioned the legitimacy of Donald Trump. And he did so not from a racial standpoint. He simply said, you know, I'm concerned about the possibility that the Russians hacked into the Democratic Party, and I feel that that calls into question the legitimacy of the candidates and the electoral process. Trump's response was highly racialized. He attacked John Lewis, the person. It was interesting because in the aftermath of that, Governor LePage of Maine sent out a tweet in which he said, Congressman John Lewis obviously doesn't know American history. Abraham Lincoln freed the slaves, and he has an apology long overdue. And I'm reading this, and I'm like, what episode of the Twilight Zone have we fumbled into when people are talking about this history in that way? But I think part of the problem is that we don't make that history accessible. So what I'd like to offer to you tonight are some reflections on civil rights history. And I say anytime you can put the Supremes up on the screen, you go for it. That's what I mean by a seasoned audience. Only some people are going to get that. I want to begin with the words of James Baldwin because they're haunting. Baldwin wrote, "The world changes according to the way people see it. And if you can alter even by a millimeter the way that people look at reality, then you can change it." Over the course of the next 35 minutes or so, I hope that I'm going to be able to alter the way that we look at and think about our contemporary moment. And I want to do that by talking about not a national Black Lives Matter movement, but I want to talk about Black Lives Matter moments. I want to begin by looking at this political cartoon from 2008 by Adam Zyglis. I love this cartoon when it came out. And it's a pretty powerful cartoon because on the surface, it just looks like Barack Obama at the front of the bus. And people look at that and they go, oh, I understand the significance of this. It's Barack Obama at the front of the bus. But this is a very powerful cartoon because it plays with two very powerful entry points in American history, civil rights entry points. The first one is that Obama's at the front of the bus, and immediately everybody thinks about Rosa Parks. So Rosa Parks at the front of the bus, right? But what kind of bus is it? See, most of us think about the two major civil rights victories of the 1950s as being the Montgomery bus boycott and Brown versus Board of Education. That the cartoonist Adam Zyglis wanted us to connect those two moments and in some sense to make the argument that the election of the nation's first black president was the completion of that arc that began with Brown versus Board of Education, that continued with the Montgomery bus boycott, and that culminated in the election of a person of color to the highest elective office in the United States. But now in this contemporary moment, we have to ask the question, how's that working out for us? Because literally, we find in this moment that most of the things that we associate, most of the victories that we associate, not only with the civil rights movement, but when we talk about gender equality in this country, when we talk about efforts to ensure the fair and equitable treatment of immigrants, all of that seems to be under assault. I say that to you because, and I don't want to be overly political, but as a historian, you can't avoid this. In some sense, when we look at this, when we talk about making America great again, and looking at altered realities, I don't want to deal with Trump per se, but I want to look at this from a historical standpoint and talk about a great book by Jason Sokol called There Goes My Everything, White Southerners in the Age of Civil Rights, 1945 to 1975. Even a 900-page book is only going to have a thesis statement that's one sentence. So I want to summarize for you Jason Sokol's thesis. It goes something like this. White folks went to bed in 1945 and the world looked one way. No black people playing baseball, no Jackie Robinson, no civil rights plank in the Democratic Party. You knew where you stood vis-a-vis the fact that you had segregation in this country, and that spelled out pretty clearly what the rights and responsibilities were for one set of Americans and what the rights and responsibilities were for another set of Americans. Two-tiered system of citizenship. And then literally Sokol writes, white folks woke up and Truman's talking about a civil rights plank in the Democratic Party, and there goes my everything. Everything that I thought I knew about my place in the society has now been brought into question by virtue of the fact that these people, who I used to see as inferior to me, are now contending for equality. And what does that mean? I can give you a very easy contemporary example of this. We all went to bed September 10th, 2001, and the world looked one way, and we got up on September 11th, and I want to be clear, there goes my everything. Everything that I thought about how we stood in relation to the rest of the world, my sense of security, when I thought I was going to retire, all those things changed by virtue of 9/11. I'll give you a very good example of this. My ex-wife used to take me to the airport in Philadelphia, and we would always be late, and I would show up, and literally I would run through the airport like OJ, bad analogy, but I would run through the OJ, remember those old TWA commercials? Again, seasoned audience, work with me. But I would run through the airport with probably a Diet Coke. Do you guys remember those days? People would be smoking in the terminal. Everybody knew me by my first name. Hi, Yohuru. Hi, Dr. Williams. You late? We'll hold the plane at the gate. No need to rush. There goes my everything. Everything that we thought we knew. Do you guys follow me here? The reason I love that and I love his thesis is because in some sense, we find ourselves in one of those there goes my everything moments. Because when you talk about making America great again, you have to ask the question, great for whom? And what greatness are you talking about when for most of our history, large sections of people have been denied access to the fruits of American democracy? Not even to mention the fruits of the American dream. You see these images, and in some sense, again, we'll go with the seasoned audience, it reminds me of Archie Bunker. And it's the theme song to Archie Bunker that was so powerful in its simplicity. Now, we all know Norman Lear produced these shows, and they were really about inclusion, but in some sense, Norman Lear's caricature of a northern bigot. Because see, Archie Bunker wasn't from Alabama. Archie Bunker wasn't from Mississippi. Archie Bunker was working class white guy from Queens. And the opening song said it all about there goes my everything and when America was great. Boy, the way Glenn Miller played. Songs that made the hit parade. Guys like... But guys like who? You guys follow me here? And you knew who you were then. Girls were girls and men were men. No ambiguous bathrooms in North Carolina. I need for you to understand that, and I'll make this point early and often. This is a long history and a long struggle that we find ourselves in. Martin Luther King described it best as the moral arc of the universe is long, but it bends toward justice. And in those moments when we see the forces of injustice overcoming it, we've got to stand up and recognize the fierce urgency of now. I love this because, in a way, he continues, "Mister, we could use a man like Herbert Hoover again. Didn't need no welfare state, everybody pulled his weight. Gee, our old LaSalle ran great. Everything was just great." But is that the America? Now, before I lose you, I'm gonna skip that one, it's too funny. We know what happened at some of these rallies, right? We talked about the violence. We talked about how the president-elect talked about these issues. And now people are trying to focus on and emphasize what motivated those people to vote for Donald Trump. Who is this American that we underestimated? What does this mean? But I think that the civil rights movement also offers us some opportunity to look at that, because what it forces us to contend with is that when you have people like Donald Trump that have no idea of the significance of John Lewis, and I want to point out to you that the point about John Lewis isn't just that he got beat at that bridge at Selma. It's what the beating at Selma led to, the passage of the greatest legislative accomplishment perhaps in 20th century U.S. history, and that is the Voting Rights Act of 1965, which enfranchised millions. The same Voting Rights Act of 1965, which a few years ago, in the midst of the whole controversy over Trayvon Martin, the United States Supreme Court gutted large sections of Shelby County versus Holder. And I think part of this is rooted not just in Trump's historical amnesia, but all of our historical amnesia. The other day it was Martin Luther King's birthday, and Martin Luther King's birthday has become the occasion at Macy's for a white sale. I just think that's funny. 40% off. We have, and I know Ed talked to you about this, in the words of Cornel West, turned Martin Luther King into a Santa Claus. He is a pale representation of the civil rights leader that tackled militarism, racism, and inequality. And we've done such a good job at it that this history no longer speaks to young people, and it no longer holds us accountable. In fact, we've turned even the I Have a Dream speech, which is a very radical speech, into a Google Doodle, which, you know, simplifies that speech into little white girls and little black girls and boys being able to go to school together in harmony, but doesn't talk about the hard work necessary to be able to do that, like tackling the poverty that prevents them from being able to occupy the same spaces. You go back to that cartoon, in some sense, we were so optimistic about 2008. But at the same time, we missed people like conservative talk show host Glenn Beck, who in 2008 was saying, and I quote him, this is a moment, he wanted to have a march on Washington in 2010. This is a moment that we reclaim the civil rights movement. It's been so distorted and turned upside down. It's an abomination. And I'm asking myself as a historian of this period, what movement is he talking about? What history are we talking about? I want to share with you a piece that was written by Jacqueline Dowd Hall in the Journal of American History, because I think it's really powerful, in 2005, where she talks about the challenges of the way that we've talked about civil rights and in some sense really gutted the meaning of the movement. She says, first and foremost, by confining the civil rights movement to the South, we talk about the civil rights movement as if it only took place in those states that were in the cradle of the old Confederacy. Our narrative is that this is a problem that was a Southern problem, not an American problem. We don't talk about the civil rights movement that took place in California that would incorporate groups like the Black Panther Party. We don't talk about the civil rights movement in New York or Pennsylvania. That movement doesn't exist for us. It's always about those major battles in the South. Second thing she says is that We confine our discussion to Bolderized heroes. That is Cornel West's point about the Santa Clausification of Martin Luther King. We turn human beings who stood up for justice, ordinary, average human beings who stood up for justice, into superheroes. And so they can't speak to our young people. Our young people think that Rosa Parks and Martin Luther King are the Avengers, that they had superpowers. They don't take into account that it was really people like Diane Nash and John Lewis who were high school and college students when they were leading those protest marches, who are also heroes of that movement. Third, she says, we confine our discussion of civil rights to a single halcyon decade. Our narrative is 54 to 68. The movement began with Brown versus Board of Education and the Montgomery bus boycott, and it ended when the Reverend Dr. King was assassinated in Memphis. See, we all know that nothing in life begins or ends neatly in that fashion. The movement began well before 1954, and the reverberations of the movement continue today. We're fooling ourselves if we say that it doesn't. Last but not least, she says, and I want to be very clear, I love this. We confine our discussion of the movement to limited non-economic objectives. We talk about the civil rights movement as if it was only about gaining the right to vote. And that's why this image of Ferguson was so damning, because you have the nation's first African-American president dealing with race riots in an American city with police who look more like an occupying army than people who were there to serve and protect. And those were all issues that we discussed in the 1950s and 1960s because King and his allies were all saying, this is much bigger, in the words of Ella Baker, than a hamburger. It's about economic justice as much as it is about having the right to vote. King talked about it in his final book, Where Do We Go From Here, Chaos or Community, when he memorably wrote, what good is it to have the right to eat in a restaurant if you can't afford anything on the menu? Civil rights without economic justice are dead rights. What good is it to have the right to go to college if you can't afford tuition? Thank you, Bernie Sanders. Civil rights without economic justice are dead rights. These are old conversations, but urgent ones. And she says, she concludes, what this ends up doing is ensuring the status of the classical phase as a triumphal movement in a larger American progress narrative. We like to say that the movement happened, and then when it ended, everything was fine. Everything was okay. Everything wasn't fine. Everything is not okay. You have a lot of work to do. I say that to you because, in a way, it reminds me of the work of Rhonda Williams, who talks about echoes. I love this book, Concrete Demands. And in the book, Rhonda says that you hear these echoes of the past, right? And these echoes are powerful. She says, look, we have to stop saying that history repeats itself. It doesn't repeat itself, nor does it rhyme, but it echoes. And you hear in the reverberations of the past the contemporary issues that continue to divide us and to limit opportunities. Let me give you a good example. Everyone is talking about Ta-Nehisi Coates' book, Between the World and Me. Now, I love Ta-Nehisi Coates. He went to Howard University. He's a phenomenal public intellectual. But if you know the history, you got Toni Morrison saying this is required reading. You have this book coming out in the midst of the National Black Lives Matter movement. But if you know the history, Ta-Nehisi Coates was very deliberate in the choice of those words as a title. Why do you say that, Yohuru? I say that because if you know the history and you go back, Ta-Nehisi Coates took that from W.E.B. Du Bois, The Souls of Black Folks, 1903, the same book in which W.E.B. Du Bois said the problem of the 20th century will be the problem of the color line. And apparently the problem of the 21st century as well. Take a look at Coates' words, Between the World and Me. Take a look at Du Bois, Between Me and the Other World. Ha ha. Because what Ta-Nehisi's doing is tapping into that DNA, recalling that, echoing that. Between me and the other world, there's this ever unasked question, Du Bois wrote. Unasked by some through feelings of delicacy, by others through the difficulty of rightly framing it, all nevertheless flutter around it. They approach me in a half-hesitant sort of way, eye me curiously or compassionately, and then of saying directly, how does it feel to be a problem? They say, I know an excellent colored man in my town, or I fought at Mechanicsville. Or do not these Southern outrages make your blood boil? At these I smile or am interested or reduce the boiling to a simmer, as to the occasion may require, to the real question, how does it feel to be a problem? I answer seldom a word. We talk about this long history. This is a famous cartoon from 1863 on the eve of the, well, just after Lincoln issues the Emancipation Proclamation. It is an ugly cartoon. It is a disturbing image. If it doesn't disturb you, something's wrong. But I like it because it's powerful in communicating exactly what Ta-Nehisi Coates and W.E.B. Du Bois are talking about. Because in 1863, the question is put to Abraham Lincoln and the Republican parties. Republican Party, congratulations, Mr. Lincoln. You just freed 4.5 million people. Now what? What's their economic status going to be in the Republic? What's their social status going to be? What's their political status going to be? And, oh, by the way, if you haven't figured these things out, then you've set the nation up. You guys follow where I'm going here, right? You can't read the caption because it's small, but it says, the man who won the elephant at the raffle, but the question is, what am I to do with the creature? It's a powerful image because there are all kinds of people, and I want to go back to this for just a second. You kind of know what the answer is, but when there was still some question about what this would mean between the Emancipation Proclamation in 1863 and the thing that really freed the slaves, the 13th Amendment in 1865, there are numerous people contending for what this moment means, what this Black Lives Matter moment means. One of those people is Frederick Douglass, who's invited to speak at the Massachusetts Anti-Slavery Society in April of 1865. And Douglass gives this amazing speech called, What Does the Negro Want? I want to share this with you because I'm going to point out to you that Frederick Douglass in 1865 is about to foreshadow the next 100 years of U.S. history. What does Douglass say? What shall we do with the Negro? I've had but one answer from the beginning. Do nothing with us. Your doing with us has already played the mischief with us. Do nothing with us. If the apples will not remain on the tree of their own strength, if they're worm-eaten at the core, if they're early ripe and disposed to fall, let them fall. I'm not for tying or fastening them on the tree in any way except by nature's plan. And if they will not stay there, let them fall. And if the Negro cannot stand on his own legs, let him fall also. That is classic social Darwinism. But why wouldn't it be? Douglass is a contemporary of Herbert Spencer and Charles Darwin. Why wouldn't it be? He's not asking for special consideration. He's not asking for affirmative action. Wouldn't have needed any of that in that moment. He says, just leave us alone, but I want to read you the second part. Then he goes on this list. All I ask is give him a chance to stand on his own legs. Let him alone. If you see him on his way to what? And I need you to be very clear with me. Fast forward 100 years and have those images of those young, the Little Rock Nine, Brown versus Board of Education. Hell, charter schools. I'm just kidding. vouchers. Betsy DeVos. If you see him on his way to school, let him alone. Don't disturb him. If you see him going to the what? Then access to places of public accommodation. Think about the sit-ins. What was that about? Access to places of public accommodation. Here is Douglass in 1865 saying, if you don't get this right now, You're gonna pay the piper for not dealing with these issues in a way that is sane and privileges our core democratic values in the moment when you have an opportunity to shape it in a way that is reflective of our best selves. And at this point, I gotta tell you, Douglass is interrupted by applause. If you see him going to the what? So Douglass has said, if you see him on the way to school, if you see him going to a place of public accommodation, if you see him trying to exercise the right to vote, don't disturb him. And the audience thinks that this is all rational. If you see him going into a workshop, if you see him trying to get a job, have a living wage, you know, without automation, you know, a real living wage, like a fight for 15 living wage, just let him alone. What you have Douglass outlining here, even before the passage of a 14th or 15th Amendment, is what I like to call the 6 degrees of segregation. Douglass just laid out the same problems that continue to haunt us to this day. Residential segregation. Lack of access to quality education. And I don't mean that in the way that Betsy DeVos talks about it. I mean a deep investment in public education. This is what the founders talked about, and a deep investment in public education means a well-funded system of public education that serves the needs of all students, not the siphoning of funds for public education to private, unregulated charters. That's undemocratic, and that's not the basis for which the system was built. We have to be honest about that. access to places of public accommodation. Jim Crow justice. Oh, what are you talking about, Jim Crow justice? Look, again, this goes back to Jacqueline Dowd Hall. But because we confine our discussion of civil rights to the South, right, we're all shocked when Eric Garner is killed in Staten Island, New York, and we watch the video. We're all shocked. You know, we expect Sandra Bland in Texas, and we expect Trayvon Martin in Florida, but we're all deeply shocked when something happens. But we shouldn't be, right? Because the Watts Rebellion began in California with an incident of police brutality. Because the Detroit riot of 1967 began in Detroit, Michigan, with an incident of police brutality. Because the Newark race riot of 1967 began with an incident of police brutality. Because, gee, can I stop now or should I keep going? The Miami Overton riot of 1981 began with an incident of police brutality. Because Rodney King in 1992 began with an incident of police brutality. And O. Ferguson, if we had corrected the issues, if we had... And these issues aren't just racial. They deal substantively with the issue of poverty. They deal substantively with the issue of immigration. They deal substantively with these things in a way that would force us to recognize how the question of poverty or even the question of gay rights factor into this larger discussion of civil rights. And so I want to end with you today, even though I'm saying it, but I probably got another 20 minutes in me. The difference between moments and movements, because I think this is the other thing that young people struggle with. A moment is a minute. It's a portion of time. It's an instant, right? It's a snapshot. And I just ran through a bunch of moments for you. Moments aren't movements. We overuse the word movement. And so we, in some sense, hurt that because a movement is a series of organized activities working towards some objective, right? Rosa Parks refusing to give up her seat began as a moment and morphed into a movement. Moments can contribute to movements. But movements are made up of moments, but they're not always the same thing. I say that to you because Trayvon Martin was a very powerful moment, wasn't a movement. Black Lives Matter has become a movement of which Trayvon Martin was a part. Why all this Common Core math, Yohuru? What is it that you're trying to tell us? What I'm trying to tell you is that if you look at the history from that standpoint, then some really powerful things emerge. I want to share with you the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King on the eve of the Montgomery bus boycott. I want to share this with you because it's powerful and it'll make my point. Now, I want to point out to you that King in 1955 has the unenviable task of trying to convince the people of Montgomery that they need to stay off those buses if they're going to win equality. He's got to convince people that this is so important that they need to stay off the buses. So the question is, what does he use to motivate them? This is a Dr. King that will be unfamiliar to you in some way, and that's why I want to share it with you. What does King say? We're here in a specific sense because of the bus situation in Montgomery, and I got to testify because that's what people are doing. Yes, preach, Reverend. And then he says to them, we are here because we're determined to get the situation corrected. But then he says something powerful. The situation is not at all what? The problem has existed over endless years. For many years now, Negroes in Montgomery and so many other areas have been inflicted with the paralysis of crippling fear on buses in our community. On so many occasions, Negroes have been intimidated and humiliated and oppressed because of the sheer fact that they were Negroes. And then King says something that's powerful that ties to what I shared with you earlier. I don't have time this evening to go into the what. But I want to point out to you that he knew the history. You guys follow me here? This is the problem, is that people don't know the history. It's not accessible. And when you don't know the history, you can't connect the dots. But I want to point out to you that the other people knew the history. King says many of them are now lost in the thick fog of oblivion. But at least one, the case of Rosa Parks, stands before us with glaring dimensions. And we mean to get that corrected. So what is King talking about? Is he just making it up? Well, I want to point out to you that even though we talk about the Civil War and Reconstruction as being this transformative moment, this is a newspaper article from Philadelphia from 1867. It shows a black man being insulted by a white man on the railway cars in Philadelphia. That is Philadelphia, the city of brotherly love. Ha ha. There's a famous case, Mary Miles versus the Philadelphia and Westchester Railroad Company from 1867, which is the Plessy versus Ferguson before Plessy versus Ferguson. I'm not talking about Philadelphia, Mississippi. I'm talking about Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. This is a famous handbill from Memphis that announces in 1868 that Negroes are to ride in the city's passenger cars. If this wasn't a problem in 1868, why is there a handbill trying to mobilize whites in Memphis to keep blacks from riding in the cars? This is a famous image from Washington, D.C. It shows a woman insulting a black woman who's sitting in a public carrier. I mention all that because, again, these are not communities where you expect to have that discussion. We talk about Rosa Parks, but I would suggest to you tonight, when we flip it, and instead of talking about movements, we talk about moments, that we could talk about Rosa Parks's, plural. And I'll give you a good example of that. Everybody knows this image of Rosa Parks. You probably know who this woman is. Her name's Elizabeth Jennings. Let me share her story with you. Elizabeth Jennings in 1854, I said 1854, was arrested in New York City for refusing to give up her space on a segregated trolley car. Ha, ha. I did say New York City. Got to share this with you because we have her affidavit about what happened. Sarah E. Adams and myself walked down to the corner of Pearl and Chapman Streets to take 3rd Avenue cars. I held up my hand to the driver and he stopped the cars. And we got on the platform when a conductor told us to wait for the next car. I told him I could not wait as I was in a hurry to go to church. I love this for a couple reasons. Got to tell young people, if you guys were getting the young people talk, not the seasoned veteran talk, what you would hear at this point is people don't wake up in the morning and decide they're going to make history today. People wake up in the morning and they've dedicated or committed themselves to justice, and it just becomes part of their DNA, and if it's right, then they're gonna stand for what's right. She continues. He then told me that the other car had my people in it and that it was appropriated for that purpose. See, in New York City in 1854, which what most people don't know is they had de facto segregation. It wasn't de jure, but it was by custom. And the way it worked in New York City is if a black person wanted to ride the trolley car, the conductor was supposed to ask the passengers if it was okay for that black person to ride, and if the passengers agreed, then the person could ride. It's demeaning and insulting, right? But it ain't quite de jure by law segregation. Why she's upset is that the conductor never asked the passengers if she could ride. He just said, the other car has your people in it. You guys follow me here? Gotta read the rest of this to you because it's powerful. It continues. It was no particular occasion because I'd wished to go to church as I've been going for the last 6 months and I did not wish to be detained. He insisted upon my getting off the car, but as I did not get off the car, he then said I should come out or he would put me out. I told him not to lay his hands on me, but he took hold of me and I took hold of the window sash and held on. He pulled me until he broke my grasp and I took hold of his coat and held on to that. He also broke my grasp. And from that, he had previously dragged my companion out, she all the while screaming for him to let me go. He then ordered the driver to fasten his horses, which he did, and come and help him put me out of the car. They then both seized hold of me by the arms and pulled and dragged me flat down on the bottom of the platform so that my feet hung one way and my head the other nearly on the ground. I screamed murder with all my voice, and my companion screamed out, "You'll kill her! Don't kill her!" All because she wants to go to church on Sunday morning in New York City. In 1854. The driver then let go of me and went to his horses. I went again in the car. They got her out. It's over. But at this point, it's a matter of, listen to me, my life matters. Black lives matter. You're not going to put me out and treat me like this, and I'm just going to accept it laying down. So she gets back into the car. Then the driver let go of me and went to his horses. I went again in the car, and the conductor said, "You shall sweat for this." An ancient term meaning you're going to go to prison. Then he told the driver to drive as fast as he could, not take another passenger, and to drive until he saw an officer or a station house. They got an officer on the corner of Walker and Browery, whom the conductor told that his orders from the agent were to admit colored persons if the passengers did not object, but if they did, not to let them ride. When the officer took me, there were some 8 or 10 persons in the car. Then the officer, without listening to anything I had to say, thrust me out and then pushed me and tauntingly told me to get redressed if I could. So you know what she did? She sued. And guess what? She won in 1854 in New York City. But the problem is the Civil War and Reconstruction that should have made that permanent became the Civil War Reconstruction that led to Plessy versus Ferguson. When you talk about Black Lives Matter moments then, it allows us to look at this in a much broader context. Shirley Chisholm, 1972, everybody talks about Barack Obama being the first black president. There are plenty of people to run. My favorite person, the first black woman, everybody talked about the historic nature of 2008 with Hillary and Barack. I was like, no, 1972 was a historical moment because that was Shirley Chisholm. And I love what Shirley Chisholm said when she was on the campaign trail. She said something that echoed the words of Michelle Obama, that everybody got upset with Michelle Obama. Michelle Obama, when her husband got the nomination, said something, words to the effect of, "This is the first time in my adult life I've been proud of my country." And people said, "Oh my goodness, I can't believe you'd say such an unpatriotic thing." Shirley Chisholm said essentially the same thing. "I was the first American citizen to be elected to Congress in spite of the double drawbacks of being female and having skin darkened by melanin." When you think about it, it sounds like a foolish reason to be vain. In a just and free society, it would be foolish if the society is in fact just and free. Christopher Eisgruber, who teaches at Princeton University, argues that American society aspires to be both democratic and just. That's tough. She continues, I love this, that I am a national figure because I was the first, look at the language she uses, not African American, not woman, I was the first what? In 192 years to be at once a congressman, black, and a woman proves, I think, that our society is not either just or free. And you could make the same argument in 2017. This is the constant struggle. Let me give you another one. I'm going to skip Booker T. Washington. I'm going to skip her too. I'm going to go to Mary Church Turrell talking about living in Washington, D.C. in 1906. Mary Church Turrell says, "For 15 years I've resided in Washington, and while it was far from being a paradise for colored people, when I first touched these shores, it has been doing its level best ever since to make conditions for us intolerable. As a colored woman, I may enter Washington any night, a stranger in a strange land, and walk miles without finding a place to lay my head, unless I happen to know a colored people who live here or ran across a chance acquaintance who could recommend a colored boarding house to me. I should be obliged to spend the entire night wandering about. Indians, Chinamen, Filipinos, Japanese, and representatives of any other dark race can find hotel accommodations if they can pay for them. The colored man alone is thrust out of the hotels of the national capital like a leper." You know, I want to tell you a story that I don't often tell, but I like this story. Michael Jordan's father was killed, and Michael Jordan left the game of basketball. Most people, seasoned audience, will remember this. Michael Jordan obviously was a millionaire at that point, had more money than anybody. His father was driving a luxury car, and yet his father pulled over to the side of the road to sleep. And that's when these two highwaymen came upon him, and in an attempt to rob him and carjack him, murdered him. People ask the question, why didn't Michael Jordan's father, who had all this money, just go to a hotel? Because his father grew up in a Jim Crow America where you couldn't assume that you would get accommodations. But if you don't know the history, he just becomes that dumb guy that didn't want to spend money on a hotel room. I don't want to lose you here, but Jack Robinson had a Black Lives Matter moment. Most people don't know that in 1944, Jack Robinson, I like to call him Jack, not Jackie, wasn't a little boy. He disliked being called Jackie. You know, that's a way to demean him in some sense. But Jack in 1944 was forced, arrested and nearly court-martialed for refusing to give up his seat on a Texas bus. People don't know this story, but what ended up happening is there had been a decree from Washington that said there was no segregation on Army bases. Jack was talking to a light-complected black woman on the bus, whom the bus driver thought was white, demanded that Lieutenant Robinson, remove himself to the back of the bus, and Jack said no. They called the civil police. The civil police came in, used racial slurs on him. Jack responded in kind. It was nearly court-martialed. It goes to a military tribunal, and the tribunal decides that Lieutenant Robinson actually acted within his rights because he had read and referred back to that military order. But I want to be clear. If Jack loses that court-martial, ain't no integration of baseball with Branch Rickey 3 years later. But I want to point out, even though he had a promising career at that point, Jack wasn't concerned about playing baseball or football. He was a four-letter athlete. He was concerned about being treated with dignity and respect as a human being and an American citizen in uniform, which to me was very powerful when I considered what happened this summer at the convention, talking about the Muslim American family whose son was lost, who's dealing with essentially the same. See, this is what we mean by, now I want to be very clear, Jack Robinson later on if you want to call him Jackie Fine, in 1964, talked about police brutality in New York City, not just against African Americans, but against Latinos. Jack in 1964 had a newspaper column that came out in the Amsterdam News, and he wrote for the Amsterdam News constantly and always took on these issues. I think our police commissioner must be warned that police brutality will not be tolerated by the Negro and Puerto Rican people of New York City. There has been too much of it, and unless it's seriously curtailed, there can be serious and crucial times ahead for the city. He said that before Watts, before Detroit, before Newark, before Miami, before Ferguson. Let me end with you on this note. If you take nothing else from this talk, I want to emphasize that wounds produce narratives. It's the trauma that people experience that sometimes contribute to the way in which they see and talk about and experience the world. And when you consider for a moment that so much trauma in the African American community, so much trauma in the Latino community has been, we see this from Emmett Till to Trayvon Martin, fixated, then suddenly you understand why Colin Kaepernick's taking a knee. Now people beat Colin Kaepernick up for this, right? Oh, why is this sports guy doing this? Because I shouldn't have to, I can put this cartoon from Daryl Cagle up from 2014, and I can read to you from James Baldwin talking about the same Harlem that he and Jackie Robinson occupy in 1964, and this is what Jimmy Baldwin writes. Similarly, the only way to police a ghetto is to be oppressive. None of the Commissioner Kennedy's policemen, even with the best will in the world, have any way of understanding the lives led by the people they swagger about in two and threes controlling. Their very presence is an insult, and it would be even if they spent their entire day feeding gumdrops to children. They represent the force of the white world, and that world's real intention are simply for that world's criminal profit and ease, to keep the black man corralled up in his place. The wound produces the story that Baldwin tells, that Ta-Nehisi Coates tells, that Mary Church Turrell tells, that Ida B. Wells tells, that testimony is influenced by the wound. I say that to you because when we look at core democratic values for elementary students, I think these are funny. Ed, I know you do work with NCSS. I threw this in the slide just for you. But I think, you know, I want to alter the way you're looking at reality. The National Council for the Social Studies says that this is what every elementary student needs to know about our core democratic values. I'm just going to read these to you because they're cute. Number one, life. Each citizen has the right to the protection of their life. Now, see, that produces one of those Christopher Eyes group retention moments, because that either means everybody has a right to the protection of their life, health care, affordable, or it means stand your ground laws, protect your crap by any means necessary. Do you guys follow what I'm, because that's a tension. Well, how are we defining what Jefferson meant by life? All people are created equal and devoured by the Creator. So among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of what life? Do you guys follow me here? Liberty, I'm sorry, the pursuit of happiness. Each citizen can find happiness in their own way as long as they don't infringe on the rights of others. So that means what happens in that bathroom in North Carolina? You guys follow me here? Third one's cute, liberty. Now you're gonna go, justice, popular sovereignty, the power of the government comes from the people. Truth, the government and citizens should not lie. Somewhere. People that wrote this are turning over in their graves. Guys, American tragedies are always born of violations of those core democratic values. Life, how come it takes 127 dead girls in New York City, this triangle shirtwaist fire, before we get to a point where we recognize that we needed regulations to protect American workers? Don't forget that Martin Luther King was assassinated in Memphis, where he was striking on behalf of sanitation workers, and the impetus that began that strike was the death of a sanitation worker and one of the machines that was used to collect the garbage in that city. We still grind human beings up in the machinery of labor, right? With little regard to their health and their safety. That's a long conversation. We can talk about this with regard to national disasters, but you can go back to Love Canal to see, everybody's talking about Flint, Michigan, but if you grew up in the 70s seasoned audience, you remember Love Canal, right? Let's pop a community on top of a landfill, see what happens. It's why I can show you a copy of Life magazine from 1967 with 12-year-old Joe Bass Jr. lying dead on the cover of Life, because he got shotgunned by a National Guardsman for looting. The irony that that's on Life magazine. Now, let me give you some good news. Joe Bass Jr. actually didn't die, but the power of that image is still remarkable. It's the reason why you can look at this image from 1967 from Newark, and you see these National Guardsmen tracing this young man down the street, and then you can look at this image of Ferguson, Missouri in 2014, and you can say, my goodness, nothing's changed. Those images are so powerful. But let me point out to you one very powerful change. At least that's the National Guard. Those are the Ferguson police. With the surplus machinery of war from Iraq filtered back into the United States to control and corral people who live in inner city communities. Do you guys follow where I'm going here? It's a long night. I promise I'm finishing up. I promise you. Somebody had a sense of humor. Moving forward. It's the reason why these images are so powerful, because I should not be able to look at Tiananmen Square in 1989 in Ferguson, Missouri in 2014 and ask this question in a very real way, palpable way, that this is a denial of democracy and justice and liberty and life and everything else that are part of those core democratic values. Look, I could talk about the controversy in Flint. Truth, the government and citizens should not lie. Water, potable water, is a human right, or should be. Just not in the United States. This is problematic. It's what we mean by long struggle. It's interesting to me that Michael Moore got harangued for saying that we should lock the governor of Michigan up, but I want to point out to you, when you talk about justice, all people should be treated fairly, they don't lock up the people who polluted the water in Flint that is going to cause health crises, which we will be paying for years as a nation, which will inevitably hurt people in that community, young people in that community, the most vulnerable, the most insecure, those most in need of protection. And yet in Flint, it is a crime to wear your pants in a sag. Where are your priorities? It is a 90, you can get up to 93 days in jail and a $500 fine in Flint, Michigan, if your underwear is showing. So we have this carceral state that we're building up, where we're warehousing, in the words of Heather Thompson and others, right? Hundreds of thousands of people. The United States is the world's chief jailer. We incarcerate more people than any of the Western democracies. And to me, you look at this and we're putting somebody in jail. Let me be very clear, because I quoted Dr. King earlier. Once you put somebody, you put somebody in jail for 93 days, they can't take care of their family, they can't go to work, now they got a jail record. Good luck for them ever getting back into the economy. They might get into the informal economy, but they're not coming back into the formal economy in any meaningful way. And I also want to point out to you that when you do that and you give them a $500 fine, this is what the Attorney General's report was saying with regard to what was happening in Ferguson. If you can't pay off that $500 fine, you're back to the black code, you're in debt. There are people who have cars that get a $20 parking ticket, you can't pay that. Then they give you another ticket, then they impound your vehicle, and then you can't go to work. Here's a simple solution, Michigan. Have your officers walk up to the gentleman in question and say, pull your pants up. I shouldn't be able to show you these images and not even have to say a word to a seasoned audience for you to recognize the power of this. Trial by jury, the all-white jury in the Emmett Till case and the all-but-one-white jury in the Zimmerman case. You know that the two men that committed that murder were acquitted and ultimately sold their story to Look magazine for $5,000, profiteered off the murder of Emmett Till. In the same way that George Zimmerman, although he's a kind of a walking disaster, was trying to sell the gun with which he killed Trayvon Martin. We go back to Colin Kaepernick, and if we look at it in that context, when you see people say things like, how dare you disrespect the Star-Spangled Banner, you got to go to James Weldon Johnson, you got to go to some of these people and who ask the question, America was never America to me. So when you talk about making America great again, whose America are you talking about? You look at that in that context, and they even have a nerve to put Dr. King standing up against Colin Kaepernick. I will bet you my last penny, if Dr. King was around, he wouldn't be standing up, he'd be sitting right with Colin Kaepernick. You know, it's funny, when Ali died, you talk about narratives. The New York Times ran an obituary of him, and I love this obituary for a couple of reasons. But the author, Robert Lipsey, said, Ali was a polarizing superstar as the sports world has ever produced, both admired and vilified in the 1960s and 1970s. But in later life, Ali became something of a secular saint, a legend in soft focus. You know what that means? That means when Ali died, we whitewashed him and we wrote out the fact that he refused to go to the war in Vietnam. We wrote out all those things about him that made him a radical and polarizing figure. And we turned him into a caricature of himself so that we could somehow claim him for a larger progress narrative that Muhammad Ali himself, the first person to don a hoodie in support of Trayvon Martin was Muhammad Ali, suffering from Alzheimer's. First athlete to do it. When you look at his life, you can see the wound that produced the narrative that was Ali's life. I love this cartoonist who said, look, Ali was the greatest not because he was the world champ, but because he was always the challenger. So when we ask people to challenge the narrative and think about challenging oppression, that's where that comes from. I want to end with you, literally now, 5 minutes left, in terms of talking about Black Lives Matter moments with the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King. I'll tell you right now, if Dr. King was here, what would he say about Black Lives Matter? You don't have to guess, because Dr. King commented on it. Did he really? He really said, hands up, don't shoot, you're making that up. No, he didn't. But I want to point out to you that the moment that led to the Selma campaign was a Black Lives Matter moment. It involved the gentleman who's pictured there. His name was Jimmie Lee Jackson. He was murdered by an Alabama state trooper. The movie Selma memorializes that. But what I want to share, and the man who killed him, Jimmie Lee Jackson, this gentleman, Bernard Fowler, was only recently arrested. He had a nice full life, had kids. Now he goes to jail. Didn't even really go to jail. But I want to share with you the eulogy that Dr. King delivered. This is a Black Lives Matter moment for Jimmie Lee Jackson. Dr. King, in eulogizing Jimmie Lee Jackson, this is what I mean by a Black Lives Matter moment, said a state trooper pulled the gun, but he did not act alone. Jimmie Lee Jackson was murdered by the brutality of every sheriff who practices lawlessness in the name of law. He was murdered by the irresponsibility of every politician from governors on down who has fed his constituents the stale bread of hatred and the spoiled meat of racism. Wow. He was murdered by the timidity of a federal government that can spend millions of dollars to keep troops in South Vietnam, and cannot protect the rights of its own citizens seeking the right to vote. He was murdered by the indifference of every white minister of the gospel who has remained silent behind the safe security of his stained glass windows. And he was murdered by the cowardice of every Negro who passively accepts the evils of segregation and stands on the sidelines in the struggle for justice. He indicted America. Everyone. Gotta skip these. Oh, you guys are missing so much great crap. Let me give you one last Black Lives Matter moment, and it's this one. Everybody talks about Mississippi Summer, right? Freedom Summer, when Schwerner, Cheney, and Goodman go missing in Mississippi. My favorite part of that is the story that happens after their bodies are discovered in that earthen dam in Philadelphia, Mississippi. And the Johnson administration, Lyndon Johnson, decides to send flowers to the family of the two missing white civil rights workers and doesn't reciprocate for the missing black civil rights worker, James Cheney. Rita Schwerner, the widow, husband has just been murdered, actually calls the President of the United States out. And she could have been comfortable in that moment to say, he's acknowledged, but she calls the President out. She goes, Mr. President, my husband, Michael Schwerner, did not die in vain. If he and Andrew Goodman had been Negroes, the world would have taken little notice of their deaths. After all, the slang of a Negro in Mississippi is not news. It's only because my husband and Andrew Goodman were white that the national alarm has been sounded. What she was saying is, Mr. President, Black Lives Matter. Everybody talks about the Black Panther Party, right? Everybody's afraid of the Black Panther Party, the big Black Panthers with their armed gun. Look, they were armed because they were practicing self-defense because there have been so many people victimized by police brutality. Wounds produce narratives. If you connect the dots, suddenly they're not that foreign. But I'll point out to you that after the youngest Panther, a guy named Bobby Hutton, little Bobby Hutton, was murdered in 1968 as the Panthers were trying to keep Oakland calm after the assassination of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King, one of the Panthers' supporters, Marlon Brando, eulogized little Bobby Hutton. So Marlon Brando, at the height of his career, at the height of his privilege, this isn't his battle. He doesn't have to get involved. He doesn't have to insert himself into this, goes to little Bobby Hutton's funeral and gives this wonderful eulogy in which he says, and I want to be clear, Black Lives Matter. So what did he say? Marlon Brando said, I'm not going to stand here and make a speech because you've been listening to white people for 400 years. They said they were going to do something, but they've not done a thing. As far as I'm concerned in re-enfranchising a black man, it's up to the individual to do something to force the government to give the black man a decent place to live and a decent place to bring up his children. That could have been my what? I want to read it again. That could have been my son lying there, and I'm going to do as much as I can. People got upset with Obama when he said Trayvon Martin could have been my son. But I would submit to you today that if we were looking at all these people, white, black, brown, indifferent, suffering from violence in any number of ways in the context of our larger society, and we thought of these people as people who could be our sons and daughters, we would be in a much better place. Then we could talk about all lives matter instead of Black Lives Matter. But right now, the trauma, the wound, is in that community. Let me conclude with you, final two slides, with the words of Lorraine Hansberry, who wrote the play A Raisin in the Sun, one of my favorite plays of all time. In A Raisin in the Sun, you guys all know it's the story of Walter Lee Younger, this black family contending for the American dream. I would give you my 45-minute version of this, but we don't have time, so let me just end here. I want to read to you the monologue of Walter Lee Younger from The Raisin in the Sun. Walter Lee is talking about wanting to be able to give his family a good life. Walter, you wouldn't understand it yet, son, but your daddy's going to make a transaction. A business transaction is going to change our lives. That's how come one day when you're about 17 years old, ha ha, little Bobby Hutton, I'll pull the car up on the driveway, just a plain black Chrysler, I think, with white walls. No, black tires. And the gardener will be clipping away at the hedges and he'll say, good evening, Mr. Younger. And I'll say, hello, Jefferson. How are you this evening? Jefferson. And I'll go inside and Ruth will come downstairs and meet me at the door and we'll kiss each other and she'll take me by the arm and we'll go up to your room to see you sitting on the floor with the catalogs of all the great schools in America around you, all the great schools in the world. And I'll say, all right, son, it's your 17th birthday. What is it you've decided? Just tell me what it is you want to be and you'll be it. Whatever you want to be, yes, sir, you name it, son, and I'll hand you the world. Well, an interviewer asked Lorraine Hansberry, this is not really a Negro play. Why, this could be a play about anybody. It's a play about people. What's your reaction? To which Lorraine Hansberry responded, well, I hadn't noticed a contradiction because I'd always been under the impression that Negroes are people. What Lorraine Hansberry was saying is, Black Lives Matter. What Lorraine Hansberry was saying, what all these people have been saying, what all this stuff tells us, what all these lessons from the past communicate to us in a very tangible way, is that when we trade in the realm of invisible, Ralph Ellison, Invisible Man, 1952, it's why DeRay McKesson wears that shirt that says, stay woke. If you read the intro to Invisible Man, Ellison lays it out. I'm invisible, understand, simply because people refuse to see me. I'm invisible because people refuse to see me. He continues, like the bodiless head you see sometimes in circus sideshows, it's as though I've been surrounded by mirrors or hard distorting glass. When they approach me, they see only my surroundings. Themselves are figments of their imagination. Indeed, everything and anything except me. I remember that I'm invisible and I walk softly so as not to awake the sleeping ones. Sometimes it's best not to awaken them. There are few things in this world as dangerous as sleepwalkers. Thank you. Because I deliberately talked too long so you couldn't ask questions. That's how the professionals do it. Yep, thank you. Got it. Thank you. See, that's it's that good, Ed?
Well, yeah, you
can. Which is good. Which is good.
Well, I always have to have a designated question because somebody, you have to answer a question.
Sure.
So, given interest and amnesia on the part of melanin deficient people like myself and others who look like me, how do we move from a master narrative that's all about people who look like me and becomes an inclusive narrative, becomes a narrative that uplifts everybody?
One of my favorite stories, Ed, is about the movie Panther, which came out in 1995. And Melvin Van Peebles, when he was making that film, talked about going to Hollywood to pitch the script to movie producers. And he says that when they got to the movie producers, they said, we got this great film about the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense, and they finally got one producer to bite. And the producer said, I love the script, I love what you guys are trying to do, I think it's a great story, but I have one request. Can't you make one of the Panthers white? So Mario Van Peebles said, but there were no white Panthers. And the producer says, you don't understand, the target audience won't be able to identify. If you can't make one of the Panthers white, how about we make a white Berkeley student who turns them on to all the radical literature that they read and kind of helps to guide them politically? So Mario Van Peebles records, so at this point we decided to play along, and so he said, so the white Berkeley student would be kind of like a radical coach, and the Panthers would be like a militant black basketball team, to which the producer replied, exactly. I love that story because in a lot of ways, it's part and parcel of what Heather Thompson expressed very well. She's the author of the new book on Attica, which she says, part of the problem with this history, whether you're talking about any marginalized people, is that those in power, and increasingly in the United States, we have to recognize that, although we like to talk about this in binaries, black and white, sometimes those binaries don't work. They usually work, but sometimes they don't work. But for the most part, when we do that, the people who are dominant want to see themselves in the center of that story. They want to tell that story from the perspective of how it impacted me. The biggest reaction I get in an audience anywhere I go is always when I talk about Jason Sokol, there goes my everything. Because people recognize that, right? I think we all recognize that. The solution to what you ask, in some sense, might be represented by the very bizarre exchange the other day between Representative Chris Murphy and Betsy DeVos in her hearings about whether she'll be the new Secretary of Education. And Chris Murphy, obviously, who's from Connecticut, where we had the Newtown Massacre, asked Betsy DeVos, what do you think about guns in school? And her response was, well, you know, we have to have guns in school because in rural communities like Wyoming, there might be a grizzly bear attack, right? And everybody laughed about that. But to me, what was powerful about that moment is that even in that moment, suddenly, a group of people in Newtown, a group of people who were melanin challenged, to borrow yours, suddenly felt what marginalized communities who've struggled with gun violence and violence in schools for years have felt. When we said, isn't there some sane way that we can deal with gun control in this country that would ensure the safety and security of Americans? Not infringing on people's rights, but doing so in a way that nobody needs access to the weapons of war, to assault rifles, to all this foolishness. For the first time, I'm sitting there and I'm watching this exchange, and I'm watching people on Twitter and Facebook post and say, I can't believe she just said that. And I'm thinking to myself, I've been on this planet 45 years. I've been conscious for ever since I was eight and kind of figured things out. I've been hearing that for 30 some odd years. That's not news to me. So it's not really an answer to your question as much as only when lions have historians will hunters cease to be heroes. Only when it touches people intimately in ways. The great thing about being an education activist is that I see this all the time. We will, we're against high stakes testing. So I'll have parents who are touched in more affluent communities by high stakes testing will come to me and go, we don't understand why we can't galvanize communities of color against this, like why they won't join us. And I said, because when communities of color have come to you and said, we have this concern about these issues, you don't show up. But now when it's your issue, you expect everybody to show up and rah, rah. Try showing up when the communities of color come knocking and say, hey, look, we're concerned about the fact that we don't have wraparound services and maybe we want to extend daycare. We're concerned. You got to show up in those battles if you want those communities to embrace your agenda. Part of the problem. Yes, sir. Andrew.
Now that we got the season version of the discussion this evening, what would be your major takeaway if this were predominantly high school undergraduate projects? What would you want them to walk away with?
My takeaway from them would be simple. I understand that people do this for rhetorical flourish, but it bugs the hell out of me, excuse my language, that sometimes we tell young people you stand on the shoulders of giants. I hate that. You do not stand on the shoulders of giants. You are the giants. The reason I say that to you is that when you do that, what you do is you take those people who've accomplished great things, the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King and others, and you make them inaccessible to those people who may be called upon to stand up for themselves. Whether you're talking about bullying in school or taking a principal stand as the Seattle Garfield High School football team did and saying, we're gonna take a knee like Colin Kaepernick. That took a lot of courage. And the reason I say that to them is that if they do something wrong, everybody's willing to talk about, what a major impact that wrongdoing did to the community. But when they do something right, I like talking about the students who integrated, or not integrated, but sat in at the lunch counter at in North Carolina A&T. They were 17, 18 years old. They were fresh out of high school, and I love when they talk about this. They said, this all started with bull sessions. We were sitting around, right, philosophizing about what we read in our textbooks in class, and we said, segregation seems wrong to us. I wonder if anybody ever challenged it. Let's just go down and sit in the Woolworths. And they had a plan, the four of them, just four. So I also like to tell young people, you don't need an army to start a revolution. The problem now is that we have all these things that in some way make the civil rights movement, all great social movements, seem so large and complicated when they really began with people who recognized that I can make a difference, that I have the power within my own power. And I love the fact, the one that I like to share with them the most, Andrew, is Melba Patilla Beals, the youngest of the Little Rock Nine, who kept a diary of her time. And she's talking about laying out, you know, her goals for New Year's 1959, 158, one of which was to do my best to stay alive to the end of the year. But what's powerful about it is that this 13-year-old girl, out of the mouth of this 13-year-old girl, she begins her meditation by saying, you would think that this being the biggest nation's biggest story, that somebody would do something to make the Central High students behave themselves. Is it that nobody cares or nobody knows what to do? I'm quoting her. That's powerful. But for me, her and her eight other colleagues knew what to do. Volunteer, go down, join, be part of the solution. That was not easy for them. Everybody looks at those National Guardsmen and they say, well, they were protected by the National Guards. Those National Guardsmen weren't in those bathroom stalls. They weren't in the cafeteria. Those kids went through hell through that year. But the ripples of what they did were tremendous and continue to impact us to this day. So my lesson to them, always to young people, is you don't stand on the shoulders of giants. You are, now look, there's a lot of responsibility in that. You can't really live up to that because you gotta learn from giants how to leave the biggest impact. So there's still a role for the history to play and for more seasoned people to play, but I wanna liberate them from this notion that somehow, in order to act, you have to speak with such eloquence, or you have, you know, we all have different gifts that are given to us. Whatever is yours and you use it in the service of others, you're acting like a giant. That's my message to them.
So it seems to me that if you need to, that even before you can act, you at least have to be aware of somebody else's situation. You have to be open to seeing that there are somebody else has a problem, that maybe they need some help. Because if you're isolated, if you're just paying attention to your iPhone and whatever is important to you, then you're not seeing anything else.
Not only do I agree with you, I think the problem that we have today is that so many people are distracted. We pick on young people, but we're distracted. You know, I'll give you a good example. There's all this unrest, civil unrest in Turkey. So I was in Ferguson with the National Alliance of Faith and Justice. And when I was I was tweeting about being in Ferguson. And I keep getting tweets from people in Turkey saying, we can't breathe. And I'm like, what is this, right? So I end up tweeting back at them, and I end up in this conversation with somebody. Long and short of it, what they were trying to say is that we got a madman over here who's president, Erdogan, who's doing all these things to journalists and to and we want you to understand that our struggle is very similar to your struggle. So I ended up writing two pieces in the Huffington Post about this and ended up becoming very much aware of and involved in what was happening there in 2014, largely because these people who were there in his pocket reached out and said, hey, guess what? Your struggle looks a lot like our struggle, and you should be aware of what's happening. So those tools of distraction, those instruments of distraction, actually can be powerful tools of organization, but they have to be repurposed. And I think part of what you suggest, and you're absolutely right, is that we've got to get people in the mindset to be looking for ways to connect and not just to plug in. Yes, sir. It's a great question. It's not told accurately at all. I think that's what Jackie Hall is concerned about. That's what historians like Ed and myself are concerned about. I think the problem for us is that we recognize that you can't go into a classroom. Andrew, you struggle with this because you're in. Any other teachers here? High school, otherwise? We all struggle with this, right? So we get, I love this. I remember going to Delaware for the first time. They said, you're going to teach Delaware history. I was like, I didn't know where Delaware was on a map before I got here. So I have this difficult challenge of, in a very short period of time, teaching young people about this critical history. And what decisions do you make? What do you emphasize? What makes the most sense? How do you convey it to them in a way that's digestible and accessible so they can go out and recognize how it impacts their contemporary moment? In that sense, we don't do a very good job because it's been reduced to a couple of paragraphs in a textbook that aims for breadth instead of depth. And I would argue that there are some moments, and I'm working with teachers in Greenwich High School in Connecticut right now, we're working through this right now, where they're saying, we want to do depth because we recognize that at this moment, it's more important for our students to pick up, you know, they can read a textbook and we're still going to assign the textbook, but we want to go deep with some issues, labor. So we want to talk about the Haymarket Square riot. We want to talk about the Chinese Exclusion Act, right? We want to talk about the Supreme Court case Gong Lum versus Rice, 1927. We want to do that because we want our students to understand and be able to appreciate that this history matters, and it doesn't always operate on these people who are luminaries in textbooks, who wind up in museums. It operates on everyday, average, ordinary people. I think that's a powerful lesson. So to answer your question, it is not reflected well because it is superficial. We understand the function of that, and we kind of work within that. But then at the same time, as Ed can note, it's also under assault. Because you've got people who say, why are we talking about, it's too much Jefferson and not enough Madison, right? It's too much Martin Luther King and not enough Cold War. And we're fighting those battles as well. So it's kind of a much more complex issue, but it's one in which if we don't figure it out, because this is, for me, one of the major problems. And like I said, we saw it play out last week. We're watching it play out right now because people don't know that history. Immigration, right? This community in particular, you know, driving in with Ed last night at almost midnight, you know, not knowing the history of this place and the people who populated it and the centuries-old conversations, people just assume, oh, there's a Latino problem, right? But the history tells you that it's much more complex and much more important for you to understand the depth of the way that those demographics play out and how it's informed that history. Great question. When it's really quiet like this, Ed, it makes me nervous. Either it was really good or it was really disturbing.
I think it was really awesome.
That's good. Oh, we got one in the back. Yes, sir. What's your name, son? What grade are you in? I think I just found a person who's going to take my job. Wow, Terrell. Wow. I'm going to steal what you just shared with me, and I'm not going to quote you. I'm just kidding. Well, it's on tape, so people are going to know, Dr. Williams got that from Terrell. That's brilliant, and I'll tell you why. It's a question that I can't answer, but it's a question that you're already beginning to answer, because you're taking what is an academic lecture about the past, right? And hopefully some words of inspiration and trying to apply them in a way that does what this woman asked, which is to be empathetic about others and find a way that within your own circle, you can do good, you can make change. You know, we used to say, it was our mantra that you think locally, but you act globally, right? Or you act locally, but you think globally. Well, any action that you take, even on the smallest scale, contributes to bending that arc of justice back toward its moral center, right? Back toward the moral authority. Because we don't think in those terms, because we teach the movement in these big cap moments, if it doesn't result in the Civil Rights Act of 1964, you weren't doing anything. The fact of the matter is, as you pointed out, this is a part I'm stealing from you, because I said it, but you applied it. Moments are made up of, first, an individual's recognition that I need to be empathetic, then I need to study, and then I need to act. And the collection of those moments, like molecules, bind together and they create movements. And like a mighty stream, those movements can wipe away all kinds of injustice. We've seen it, we've documented it. It's a phenomenal question. I got a job for you at Fairfield University, so look me up. I like that. Just don't come too quick, because I got about, well, you, how old are you? Good, then I got plenty of time. By the time I retire, we'll be ready to roll. You got a good 10 years. This is perfect. Good timing. Great question, Terrell. I think that's it. Thank you up in the back. I'm going to do this very quickly. The first one is obvious, and it'll sound, it usually sounds insincere unless you do it in the context of a presentation like this. Donna Murch wrote this great book called Living for the City and the Black Panther Party. She starts by talking about how the Black Panther Party started in a study group, right? Martin Luther King talked about knowing your history. I told you that the North Carolina A&T movement began with students meeting together. The women's movement begins with students, right? So the first thing is read and study, because if you don't have anything to share, if you're not connected to the history and you can't walk into a situation and point out to people why it's wrong and point to concrete examples of, then you're at a disadvantage, right? You're just reactive instead of being able to go on the offensive and to talk about things in a way that says, look, this has gone on too long and this is why I think that we need to move. Secondly, and it's tied to what you said, but I'm gonna simplify it a little bit. Be prepared to be uncomfortable. And most of us aren't prepared to be uncomfortable. It's a lot easier to shrink from what we perceive to be confrontation when we encounter ignorance, because we assume that when you try to share it with somebody else, it's going to result in some kind of a conflict, right? You can't, the one thing that I love about Ella Baker, who was the woman behind the civil rights movement, is she wasn't afraid of making people uncomfortable. And sometimes that's a look. Right? Sometimes that's going to the people who are your intimates and familiars. One of the things that I love about Freedom Summer, when SNCC in 1966 decided that they were going to expel whites from their membership, and this upset people. And so why did you kick your white members out? And the African Americans in SNCC said, our problem is that we get a lot of white students to come down and want to go into the South and help register the people to vote and all this. But it has negative consequences in the fact that it doesn't allow us to build indigenous leadership. So we got to get these people here to be informed and to act for themselves. But more importantly, there's work that those people need to do in their own communities. It's very easy to get on a bus and come to Mississippi, where the problem is, and tell people how they it's another thing to sit across from the people at your dinner table and the people you go to school with and that you ride the bus with and that you work with and call them out for injustice. The ripples there can be as powerful and as great because you force accountability in the spaces, as you indicated, where generally there is no accountability because no one speaks up. You know, it's the tyranny of the silence that goes along with conformity. And the last piece simply is, you know, find within yourself, and this is difficult for all of us, the strength to love and then the strength to act. And I say that because, and I know Ed has talked to you about this, we simplify nonviolence to the point that we, you know, turn it into a character. But what I like the most about Martin Luther King's book, The Strength of Love, is he's very clear that the strength of love simply means that you don't inherently see the people that you're going against as evil. When you believe in the inherent humanity of people who take positions that are polar opposite to you, you invest in the idea that you are in a process of reclamation or redemption, not one of conquest. It's liberating. Like, I'm not interested in defeating anybody at the polls or any place else. I'm interested, and if you look at it, this was the slogan of the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, to reclaim, to redeem the soul of America. I say this to young people in a slightly different way. I was just in Florida the other day talking about this. Because sometimes you just got to put it in the places they understand. Movie Star Wars came out. George Lucas, when he first wrote the Star Wars trilogy, called Return of the Jedi Revenge of the Jedi, and then decided, I can't call this Revenge of the Jedi because revenge isn't a Jedi term. Young people then suddenly get exactly what I'm talking about, right? If you're going out to revenge people, you lose the moral authority to be in a conversation from the standpoint that you're saying, hey, look, I'm just trying to make this a better place for everybody. Hey, look, I'm just trying to clear a path where we all could be comfortable. Hey, look, I'm just trying to point out to you the ways in which your worldview is limited. Hey, look, I'm just trying to say to you that there's space for all of us to live and survive, and isn't it better to think about that in a way where we privilege our shared humanity rather than thinking about it as people who are so foreign and distant from us that they're beneath us and other. Give you a very different way that you deal with your enemies. Very different. Great question.
Mm-hmm. And then in education, presented as this is what happened, and it has to be an ongoing, if we really want to, this has to be an ongoing standard. Not just, well, it ended in 1964 or whatever.
You're absolutely right. And if we did that, then it wouldn't be so jarring to people. I remember Shelby County versus Holder coming down. And I remember just people's reaction. They were like, first of all, you get the you know, we're talking about fake news now, but a million people were contacting on Facebook. Black people are going to lose their voting rights. I'm like, it's not that simple. I wish it was that simple. It's far more insidious than that. The protections that were put in place, pre-clearance, to ensure that people that lived in those counties at risk will be wiped away, and that opens the door for all the political chicanery we saw in the aftermath. So that's more dangerous, because guess what? That's not just going to touch black folks in Mississippi. That's going to touch poor whites. That's a much bigger, much broader discussion. If we can get people to that point, right, of doing exactly what you're talking about, it's an easier ask. But what happens is people go, oh, well, that's a black person issue, or that's a black thing. At the same time, what we don't want to do is create this narrative, and this really disgusted me, where it's all lives matter. No, you got to deal with the wound. If you say all lives matter, you're negating that the people that are suffering, for the most part, are coming from a particular group, and that's an issue. So you're running from the issue. Blue lives matter. You're running from the issue. It can't be, it's not that all lives don't matter. Certainly all lives matter. But if you believe that, deal with the communities that are suffering with the wound. And then it makes it more sincere if later on you go, I care about Black Lives Matter because I also believe that all lives matter. And this is where these tensions are taking place, and I got to address them. People don't want to do that. They want to run from it and act like that, you know, can't we all just get along moment ends up subverting our impulse to reach out to those that struggle. Now, if you look at this in a Judeo-Christian context, which makes some people uncomfortable, but I have to share with people all the time, Malcolm X is a minister and so is the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King, and most of those meetings took place in churches, right? You administer to the least, to those that are suffering, right? Malcolm X said it the best. When Jesus Christ came, he didn't go to the Pharaohs. He went to the suffering. He went to those who were marginalized. So if you're going to follow that model, right? Now, you could take it out of Judeo-Christian. You could put it in Gandhi. You could put it in Muslim, Islamic, term, whatever it is. You deal with those who are suffering, right? That's simple, not complicated. But I think the interesting thing about where we are in our contemporary moment is because we've simplified the movement in those ways, because we've made it a simple progress narrative, because we've turned Martin Luther King into Santa Claus, who gave this really phenomenal speech and then got shot. Most kids can't even tell you what he was there for. Why did Martin Luther King get assassinated? Because he wanted black people to be free. Now, black people were free. That wasn't the issue. More complex than that. And Memphis is more complex than that. And Birmingham is more complex than that. And Ferguson is more complex than that. And Alamosa is more complex than that. We're more complex than that. I really have to let you go because it'll be all night. It'll be like, you can't come back. Thank you.